evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another edition of What's Happening. I'm George Binns, and I'm along with Gail Burke, Elliot Margolis, and Stuart Gardner. And the issue tonight we want to bring up is the red book that everybody got a copy of from none other than William Francis Galvin. And the issue that he's bringing up is the three questions that are on the ballot. The first question has to do with how many patients a nurse can handle. And it's a rather detailed law that they're trying to propose. It depends on what kind of service they're in, whether it's an intensive care unit or an emergency room. And so it's pretty detailed. So, Elliot, what do you think?
Okay, what do I think? First of all, George, one of the most important things you have to know is that the union is in favor of this. Therefore, we need to be opposed to it. Because the union is less concerned about the patients and more concerned about, say, nurses getting paid more money and being fully staffed. They don't care what the hospital needs are. They don't know what the hospital needs are. Nurses know what the hospital needs are. Doctors know what the hospital needs are. The administrator knows what the hospital's needs are. The people who are in favor of that proposal are saying that the administrator wants to make sure that the hospital makes money, therefore he's going to short-staff people. My suggestion would be that the administrator has to make sure that people get good health care and therefore can't short-staff his people and needs to give good care. Plus, let's just say, when you look at what happened in Boston at the marathon, over 180 people got hurt. Not one person who got hurt in that and got sent to a hospital passed away. Not one. Because the hospitals were able to call in more people and get things done. And everybody came out fine with that. What question one is saying is, okay, the government should determine how many people should be staffed in a hospital. Well, my question is, what the heck does the government know? The government, with all due respects to it, the government has too many lawyers in there in state rep positions. Lawyers know nothing about business. They know nothing about hospitals, and they're going to tell a hospital how to staff? I don't think so.
Oh, come on.
Well, you know, it's funny with this first question. I think this is where the red seeds come together, because while I disagree with your union comment, I disagree with your lawyer comment. Here's the thing. I don't know. I agree with you. I don't know what the right ratio for nurse to patient is, and I don't think some arbitrary body should make it either. We consistently have the best hospitals in the country. I think you get excellent care in Massachusetts. In theory, I like the law. I mean, you know, you'd hope that an administrator would be prudent and go, okay, this nurse has too many, this nurse doesn't have enough. You know, I'm not concerned about the money, I'm concerned about the patients, and that's the way I'd like to believe it. I'm not in favor. I'm not 100-0, I'm 51-40 and against this rule, simply because I think the hospitals know how to run their business and they should be left alone, unless there's some sort of complaint system that comes in and then at some time we make changes.
Well, is there a doctor in the house? Because I think you agreed with me, dear.
This is the first, this is the one and only time.
I think one of the first things that we have to consider is something like an emergency room. Now, an emergency room can be very quiet and an emergency room can be overwhelmed. So I think if there's a law saying that you can only have four patients to one nurse, what happens to the emergency rooms? Somebody's gonna die. Somebody's not gonna get the proper care. I've had conversations with former nurses, and they have told me that is absolutely a horrendous thing to do to nurses, because if you're on a floor and you have four patients, maybe they're sleeping, or maybe there's three of them that don't need you at the time, but somebody in another area does, and they can go to that other area to help out. So I think it's putting patients in danger. I think that we should vote no on question one.
The problem I see with this one, I'm violently opposed to it, is number one, I don't think an arbitrary law can really describe a flexible situation like you both described. They talk in here about the pros and cons of, well, it's going to cut down on problems. The first exposure I had to the problems in the hospital is I read a book, 2000, written by James Glick, and there's an article in there by Dr. Antil Gawande. He's an oncology surgeon in Boston and Harvard. And he mentioned, among other things, that like the number three cause of deaths in the United States is medical mistakes. And he was quoting a number like 98,000 a year in the United States. The most recent numbers I've seen are 400,000 a year. It's a horrendous problem. And to pass a law like this without looking into how many nurses are making fatal mistakes in the hospital, I don't think they have the foggiest idea. I don't think they've got a solution that fits the real problem. And that's where I think the emphasis ought to be, not to come up with a bright idea that, oh, we'll just add more nurses. The other part of the problem is, depending on whose numbers you listen to, this thing could cost someplace between $500 million and $1 billion a year, added to the cost of medical treatment in the state of Massachusetts. Right now, our budget is squeezed tight, paying for Medicare, Medicaid, MassHealth. Where are they going to get the money from? And the other issue that comes up is, if you have to add more nurses to the hospital, where are you going to get them from? Yeah, it doesn't happen. So they're going to take them from the other places that need nursing helps, like nursing homes and palliative care places. And it's not a problem you can ease into. This just says, 1st of January, you got to have these ratios. There's no transition. It's a poorly written process.
And just to point out, so we can move on to the next one, California has a law like this. It's costing them a fortune, and it's not working. So if it's not working there, well, maybe that's not a good example.
Well, that's a good reason to vote it down.
Yeah. If California has it, we don't want it.
Yeah.
I just want to add one thing. I think in theory it's a good rule. In other words, I want there to be some sort of check system on the administrations, on the insurance companies to go, okay, we don't want to understaff, right? We want to make sure that everyone gets good care. What that number is and what that nurse ratio is, I don't know.
I have a fundamental problem with people who are not in the business setting the rules and regulations.
They should set the standards. Yes.
And we'd have a performance kind of specification as opposed to a design spec.
Yeah, I'd rather see like a complaint commission that does like studies for a couple of years that looks into this type of thing and says, okay, everyone's fine except for this or this is good and this is bad. I agree. I think the law is a little premature. And as I said, in theory, I like it, but I'm voting no on it.
I can't believe that I'm agreeing
this
with you
where,
either.
We're going to part after this,
okay.
So don't worry about it.
Now we're moving on to number two.
Number two.
There is a concern in this country, spoken very vehemently, about corporations spending money on campaigns, supporting candidates, issues. And there's a lot of people who think that corporations are not people. Therefore, they shouldn't be able to spend this money. And so the Massachusetts Wizards think we ought to have a commission to study this issue. And that's what question two says. Let's form a commission. And again, Stuart?
First of all, corporations aren't people. So everyone thinks that corporations are people. But corporations don't breathe the air that they pollute. Corporations don't drink the water that they pollute. And I think someday, I think too much money in politics won't matter because people will be prudent enough to know lies from the truth, prudent enough to know fake news from real news, prudent enough to be able to tell so that you could spend billions of dollars on all the ads you want and it's not going to make a difference. That doesn't exist right now. So that money, every dollar that the corporation spent is so important. It's obvious. You can see it. You can see it in Congress. You can see it with the president. You can see it even with the Supreme Court. You can see now the influence of money in those things. And what we have to do is we have to be able to limit what corporations provide because they're just too rich and too powerful. And the only way to do that is to get rid of Citizens United, and the only way to do that is to start this type of process.
The campaign in Texas going right now for Senator.
Oh, Mark. No. Beto O'Rourke.
Mm-hmm. He is outspending, he is outraising his competitor.
Yeah, it's Texas.
By a gazillion dollars.
I don't know the numbers, yeah.
And he's behind in the polls. Yeah. So well, the money doesn't necessarily buy votes.
That's a bad example. It's Texas. It's a completely red area. It's evangelical. You know, why they like Ted Cruz. If you guys like Ted Cruz, nobody likes Ted Cruz.
Let's take the United States of America.
Sure.
Okay? And Hillary Clinton versus Donald Trump.
Yes.
Who spent more money?
I don't know.
Hillary Clinton.
Oh, yeah. I'm not saying that I want the Democrats to have the money. I want the money pulled out of it.
But you also said a few things about corporations. Corporations are the one that pollute the waters.
They do.
All corporations are not bad.
Agreed.
Okay.
Just the bad ones.
Okay,
you have to bring in the unions. They're not saying that unions can't give the money. And the unions, especially the NEA, are the worst perpetrators of everything.
We need
fraud.
There has to be limits on money coming in.
I agree with you there, but you don't say we'll overturn Citizens United and everything will be fine.
I don't necessarily want to do that. Well, isn't that what this whole law's about? Start a commission to look into how to deal with this money in politics. And one of the big problems is Citizens United. It says,
but the Supreme Court said citizens can be considered.
I'm just kind of curious about something.
Please.
I mean, no.
How many corporations have no people?
How many corporations have no people? Yeah. How many corporations have no people with morality?
No.
People with soul?
Because corporations are not only people.
Yep.
And people have the right to speak, First Amendment. And people have to live where their corporations are, so they are drinking the polluted water if that happens. Breathing the polluted air if that happens. So the point being, corporations have a right to spend the money to try and elect somebody that's going to do what's going to be in their best interest. What's in their best interest? Healthy people who work there for a long time, and not to pollute.
I'm not sure if I agree with that.
And then you've got the federal government giving certain regulations on the air and the water.
If we go back to the very first question, here we have a case of the government setting regulations on how to run your business. Happens to be a hospital.
Right.
Shouldn't the corporations be able to influence the politicians?
Maybe. Some of it. What's going on in Everett right now? They're building a big casino. Do you guys know how much it cost them to clean up that area, that brown field that was by Monsanto? Over $150 million.
Yeah.
Why? Because Monsanto didn't give a rat's butt about its employees or about the area
right.
it was
and
in.
How long ago was Monsanto there?
50 years ago, I don't know.
40 okay,
years
ago. And
but
did
Monsanto
we know about all this pollution 50 years ago?
Yeah, Monsanto is always
Monsanto
the bad guy.
Is always
I agree.
The
so
bad
is Exxon.
All
so
corporations
is,
are not like Monsanto.
But so fine. I'm not talking about your mom and pop stores. I'm not talking about your 20-person corporations. I'm talking about your Exxon Mobil. I'm talking about Monsanto. I'm talking about Dow Chemicals. I'm talking about these big companies whose only goal is to maximize shareholder value. You guys want to defend them. I don't know why. Which corporation do you like? Facebook, the one that releases all your information on the web? Or the airlines that pack you in like sardines?
No one
Which
is saying.
Which one of these corporations you guys like? They're great.
I didn't hear anybody say all corporations are great.
But
they're not
no,
all great.
This is not an issue about
but it's not
good
all
and bad
corporations.
Corporations. It's an issue about do we need to have another commission to go look into an issue that has been settled at the Supreme Court. If you want to change the thing, then the states have to get together and have a constitutional
convention. That's what this is about. That's what this is about, how to create a constitution.
We don't need a commission to decide
that.
We have people
that we elect to office. Why don't they do it?
Because
we don't want, here in Massachusetts, to appoint a commission. What is that going to look like?
What the commission's going to do is it's going to find out methods and ways to disturb Citizens United, to disturb money in politics. And I think that's a noble cause.
Can you imagine this legislature, what kind of a commission they would appoint? You'd have 14 liberals and one token conservative.
It would be like this, except the opposite.
But not only that, it's an unpaid commission. So the only people that will be on the commission, because people can't take time off from work if they're not being paid, is corporate executives. It's not going to work.
There's a ton of people that will volunteer their time, and I think it's great. I think I think it's noble, I think it's moral, and I think it should happen.
I think we should have our legislators do it. That's what they get paid for.
So we got what?
Oh, no. They're only part-time. Remember, just because they get full-time pay and full-time benefits and per diem doesn't mean they're not part-time.
That's another issue. Anyway,
okay.
Moving on to number three where the fun really starts.
Okay.
This is my favorite one, and I'll tell you what happened today. I was listening to Jeff Kuhner on the radio. This is the transgender anti-discrimination bill.
Right, that's already on the books.
It's on the books. And it's already there. So what is happening? The people that are in favor of keeping it keep saying, well, you know, we haven't had any problems with it yet. Well, unfortunately, we have had problems with it, but they never make the papers. So today, Jeff Kuhner on the radio was talking about a woman who went into a Target store in Woburn with her 10-year-old daughter. The 10-year-old daughter had to go into the ladies' room. She was in there. The next thing she knows, somebody, a man, is crawling under the stall to get to her. She was 10 years old. She started to cry and scream. She was able to get out of there and run out of the bathroom before he was able to get in there. That's an incident. That is an incident of public safety. A little girl, what was he doing in there?
He was identifying
as a woman
at the time.
Today.
So hold on, let's step back for a second.
Public safety.
I wanna say that I'm not in love with this law. Yeah. So again, it's not cut and dry. I'm not like, hey, jump full force. I think the whole transgender issue has been pushed too fast, too far, too fast. That being said, I think that someone's going to commit a crime is going to find a way to commit a crime. In other words, you're saying that this law allows them the cover, right? A man walks into a woman's room, claims to be a woman. Let me step back in. I got a question. Do you believe that people are transgender?
Yes.
So I think that they can be, but I question, first of all, what is the percentage of transgender people make it's like point in Massachusetts? It's 0.65.
But you do believe that a man can be born in a woman's body and a woman can be born in a man's body?
I don't think transgender per se. For instance, take someone like Bruce Jenner. Bruce Jenner was a man. Or he is
a man.
He still is. That will never change.
Right.
I don't care what he has removed. He's still a man.
Yep.
Okay? And he was the poster child for transgender.
Right.
And where is he now?
So you guys like to cite a lot of personal examples. I know plenty of people that I will look at you with a straight face and say, they're physically a woman, they're anatomically a woman, but they're men. Or they're physically in a man's body, but the women, they're not gay. I'm not talking about their sexuality. I'm talking about that they're definitely the opposite gender. And that would be from birth. In other words, this is before even the whole big issue. This is like when I was 10 years old, when I was 15 years old, the people I met, which was obvious for the other person. So I think once we can buy that there is really the transgender people, I think the issue is, you're right. Now, are we opening the door for miscreants, for malfeasance amongst a certain population? We're not worried about women going to men's rooms. We're worried about men going to women's rooms. But my opinion is, it's a valid point. But if someone's going to commit a crime, they're going to find a way to commit a crime. They're going to go in and hide. They're going to do something.
That's true. But why make it easier for them? In a case like a Target, it's real simple. You've got a men's room. You've got a ladies' room. You've got a family restroom.
Yeah.
Go to the family room.
I love that option. Yeah. I think this issue is for places without third restrooms.
Then what needs to happen, unfortunately, would be you put a lock on the door. You go in, you lock the door, and
a single bathroom.
Yeah.
And that's what a lot of places have done.
Yeah.
So that men and women can go in there separately because there's only one bathroom.
Sure.
That's what Starbucks does now. They have a men and women picture there, but one person can go in, lock the door, No problem.
I told you, I'm not in love with this law. I'm 51-49 in favor, so there would
but,
be a...
But think of it in a school, for instance.
We're making progress with
you know what I did? Because I talked to this about with my daughter. She said, it's a problem for older men. In other words, the issue isn't a 15-year-old or 20-year-old boy.
Well, they start someplace.
It's the older men. It's not... My daughter said, you know, this is just, again... anecdotal, because it's only Beverly High School, but she said it's not an issue. She said, you know, amongst her peers, there is no malfeasance in this particular area.
I would find that questionable. Well, only because perhaps she hasn't seen it. Perhaps they think, like young kids do, oh, it'll never happen to me. But if kids are born a certain gender and they're not that gender, as you said,
right.
And they identify as something else, they become teenagers. And this opens the door for them to go into the locker rooms,
but not only
the
that,
bathrooms.
In Beverly High School, for instance, let's just say, and you earlier today you called me old, so let's just say I'm an old man, and I'm in the school here, and I'm substitute teaching.
Yep.
Okay? Now I have the next period off. That means I could go up to the girls' locker room, walk in while they're showering, just because I feel like a woman.
So I think...
That's what this law allows.
I guess what the law is saying, and if people vote for it, or in other words, they keep it going, what they're saying, that's against the law. I understand that it's a fine line, and you're saying I could certainly do it, but if you go in just to oogle at girls, or you go in to do this, what this guy did, crawling under the thing, if you get caught, you're going to go to jail. That's against the law, right?
But you know what happens? If somebody reports it, if the mother reported it, she could be fined. She could be fined $25,000 under this bill.
So, a crime is a crime. If the individual is in there just to oogle, or the individual is in there to commit some sort of crime, that person should be subject to justice and go to jail.
Okay.
So let me just say, if we do vote to continue this law, which I'm going to, I think what we're saying is that we're hoping that. We're leaving unfortunately, some people out for bait, and we're hoping that the people that actually get caught and go to jail, and we put away that segment of society. That's a segment of society that should not be around anyway.
Okay, but here's the thing.
But they are, Stuart. That's the problem.
Talking about what happened today, okay? Now, I could easily drop this pen and go down and go pick it up and then oogle that way. But, hey, I just dropped my pen. I was just going to pick it up.
An oogler is an oogler. If someone's going
to... No, it isn't.
We're getting
down
to an issue of we're trying to pass a law.
We've already passed the law.
Yeah. And it's softer than a boiled grape. There's a little phrase in there. It says, gender identity is defined as a person sincerely held gender-related identity. If somebody decides they want to be female today, they can. If they want to be male today, they can. I think it's a little premature to get into this thing if we got the definition of gender identity that's that soft. I understand what you're saying. Some people have a feeling. We used to call them tomboys.
Yeah. The only thing I'm going to say about this issue that's different than you guys is I'm on the front line. I have two young kids that are involved with a lot of these types of kids. And... Some of the issues are too much for them. I don't like the idea that I don't even know what gender fluid is. But some of the kids are like, you know, one thing one day, one thing a day. I don't like that.
That's exactly
I don't
the
like
problem.
That. I'm talking about the real transgender community, the people that unfortunately I can't speak for, and I'm not doing a great job.
Yeah, no.
That are truly women in men's body and men's women's body, and what they want, and they're already dressed up like the other person. I love the idea of having a single bathroom, but in places that don't, I think it's still I'm still okay with if you are truly a transgender person, you use the bathroom that you feel that you're.
But see, I'm in your position. Too, because I have a 7-year-old granddaughter who's in the first grade. I could take her into the store and have this happen to her as well.
I hope it doesn't.
Now, what happens in Massachusetts, 0.57% are considered transgender.
So what's there, 7 million people in Massachusetts? And 0.5% is
it's
what, 350,000?
Well, this says about 30,000.
30,000.
Across the state. That's a small... minuscule number. Why do we have to? Why do we have to have a bill for a tiny segment of the population when we can do it other ways?
Well, the other part of the problem is, what difference does it make what bathroom you use if you're transgender? So, is there some stigma attached to saying, hey, I think I'm a girl today, but I have to use the boys' room? What is the problem with that?
The girls' rooms do not have the same facilities as the men's rooms.
No, I understand that.
We're going to get to you.
Pretty soon they may.
Let's hope not.
Anyway, you wanted to raise another issue.
Yes, I did.
We're going to beat this one to death and get nowhere.
This is question four.
Yes, question four.
I'm just questioning the booklet itself, because a lot of people have been complaining
the propaganda
that it has been used as an advertisement for Bill Galvin, who is running for re-election. And on the back page, it gives things that he has done during his time as Secretary of State. And at the top it says, if you have been the victim of investment fraud, Secretary Galvin's office might be able to help. And then it lists a few things down here that he has done. Is that considered free advertising per the taxpayers paying for this booklet? Should that be discontinued for him, to allow him to do that?
I'm not in love with it. I don't like it. I remember when, with the lottery, I forget who it was, one of the treasurers was printing out coupons to get a free lottery ticket, and basically they were turning the money in and, you know, he was paying for advertising with the dollars they were printing up and stuff like that. I think that the government's been doing this since day one.
Right, but they could easily just change that to Secretary of State's office.
Yeah, I'm not in love with it.
Yeah.
You know, and you change it to the Secretary of State's office.
Power of being an incumbent, though. You know, incumbents have more power. That's just the way it is.
They do. But I think we in Massachusetts could begin to change that with some oversight of how these booklets are printed.
I wouldn't oppose it.
Okay. Well, we're almost out of time. Final words for everybody?
I'm just pleased to see that we're having a little effect on Stuart.
I noticed that.
No, you're not.
Yes.
He's coming. No, on one. Yes on two. Yes on three.
No.
You just have to just all you say is no. No. Yeah. I know,
same
George.
Thing.
No. No times three. No times
no,
three.
No. For me as well.
Yeah. I had one no.
Okay.
Thank you all for being here. We've had a good time. We're going to continue doing this, if you can stand it. We have fun doing it, and we try to provide a lot of information, and we hope you enjoy it. So join us next time on What's Happening.